pause between there. Okay.
Thank you.
before I ask the worship team to come up. Dear Lord Jesus, I just want to thank you for this beautiful opportunity you've given us this morning to come together as believers and worship you. It's a wonderful thing, and it fills us up, it charges us, energizes us, puts us into contact with each other again. And Lord, I just want to thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for your presence here. Thank you for your spirit here. I thank you for this opportunity to be taught by you and to worship you in the many different ways that we can. And Lord, I just want to thank you for those who came and joined us here this morning. I thank you again for your spirit that's here. And Lord, I just want to pray this in your great, wonderful name, Lord. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I too would like to welcome everybody here. And for this morning, as to open our time of worship, I'd like to read a verse from Psalm 150, verse 6, that says, "Let everyone who has had two cups of coffee this morning praise the Lord." Is that what it says? Or that's everybody that their life just smoothed by this week. They made X amount of money and life is perfect. Praise the Lord, right? No, it says, "Let everything that has breath praise the Lord." I'd like to read the whole chapter. It's only six verses to begin. It says, "Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary." That's where we are. "Praise God. Praise him in his mighty heavens. Praise him for his acts of power. Praise him for his surpassing greatness. Praise him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise him with the harp and the lyre. Praise him with the timbrel and dancing. Praise him with the strings and the pipe. Praise him with the clash of cymbals. Praise him with resounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord." So for our opening song this morning, we'll sing "Light of the World."
Beauty that made this heart
next song, we're going to be singing Just As I Am. And recently, as I've been coming to times of worship, I've been convicted. Sometimes I put expectations on myself when we begin worship that I need to be convicted of this and this and this, or I need to confess deep spiritual things. And sometimes you put such high expectations on yourself that it kind of blocks your worship. And that's just something that I've been trying to struggle with lately. And then sometimes I feel like, do you want God, all you want is just simple praises. If that's all that comes out naturally and comfortably, we don't need to, for every time of worship, search deep and strong and confess this convicting thing. And so as I was preparing for worship this Sunday, I found the song Just As I Am, and it's another classic hymn. And I just thought that put into words just exactly what I was feeling. We don't need to, we just give God us ourselves just as we are.
Down at you.
Thank you, worship team, for leading us in worship. Next, I'll call on the Sunday School Committee to come out for the presentation of Bibles.
Good morning again. Another wonderful morning. It's a pleasant day today, handing out Bibles for the kids from 5 years and 8 years. It's a good thing to do. We enjoy it. And I would like to call on the kids that are born in 2016, that are turning five this year. Could you please come up? All the kids that are born in 2016 and that are 5 years old. Gideon. Is that you? Lincoln Friesen. That's you.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Hudson Dick.
Thank you.
Any more kids that are 5 years old? Thank you, kids, for coming up. Is there anyone that we missed? If not, then I would like to call all the 8-year-olds to come up. All the ones that are going into grade 3. Thank you again. So, thanks for coming up. Or are there any kids that we missed that are 8 years? Not, thanks a lot.
Thanks, Duff and Stanley. I hope they make good use of those Bibles. You need to wear them out. They're no good if they don't get worn out. Let's go ushers, can we get ready to take the offering? Let's ask God's blessing on the offering before we take it. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you for the riches you've provided us with. I thank you for the blessings that you've provided us with. I thank you for being able to provide for those around us. Thank you for the gift of just having something to do with our hands. And many places they don't have that, and many times we take that for granted as well. But Lord, everything comes from you. You have blessed us richly with it. And as we give back to you, Lord, I pray that your name be glorified. May we not be tight-fisted with giving back to you, but but that we graciously give back to you that which you've blessed us with. Praise your name. Thanks for your gifts. I'll call on Henry to come up for the teacher dedication for the school board, as well as school board members that want to come up. And following that, Pastor Henry will give us the message.
Good morning. This morning we want to do a teacher's dedication prayer, as we know that school is just around the corner. School is about to start on Wednesday, and we entrust our children to the teachers for them to teach our children. And I think it is an important step that we keep them in our prayers. And so I will give it over to Stanley if he wants to say anything here.
Good morning. Thank you all for coming out. Yes. We are getting ready for another school year. We are excited. We've done lots of prep already, and teachers are already had a good week at school getting to know each other and getting a little bit of training, and I think everybody is very excited to get going. And so we just have some little steps for God to get done for us yet, but we know He is willing and able, so we'll trust Him on that. But yeah, I guess at this point we'd like to call up the teachers and we'll pray over them and dedicate this year to God.
If you want to grab a mic, you could maybe grab that mic there. I think at the bottom here.
Okay, you hear me? I think we're not quite all here, right? There's how many missing? Okay, but yeah, I'll start with a prayer. This is the team, and I'll start, and then Henry will pray after me. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this beautiful morning. We thank you for each one of these willing persons that is willing to be used for your honor and glory in the school. And we pray, Jesus, that you would be able to use each one of them for your honor and glory and help us to keep in mind that what we are doing is furthering your kingdom. And we just want to pray for them and dedicate them to your service. And we pray, Jesus, that your angels would camp around the school this year and that you would protect us, that you would guide us. I pray that you would be with the board, help them to make the right decisions, and pray that you would give them wisdom and strength. And I pray especially for strength for the teachers. I pray for health. I pray for physical health, mental health, spiritual health. And I just pray for openness. And we just pray that you would be in the midst there, that you would guide them and lead them. In Jesus' name, amen.
May I ask the congregation to stand to show your support? Father God, we come before you once again, and God, I thank you for these teachers. I thank you that you have placed a calling on their lives, and Father, I thank you that they have answered to that. And Lord, as we entrust our children to them to teach our children, Father, I pray that you will give the teachers much wisdom, give them much love, and give them guidance, give them the ability to know when to speak and when to just show love and what to do in every circumstance, Lord. And Father, I pray that you will remind the teachers that they are not unseen, even though sometimes it may seem to them that they're behind the scenes, that it's not really about them, but they are planting into our to the next generation and generations to come. They are sowing seeds in them. And Father, I pray that you will be with them, that you will give them much guidance, and that you will bless them. And Father, I also pray for the students that will be under their authority in school there, Lord. I pray that you will give them obedient hearts and that you will give them a desire to learn. And Father, I just place these teachers into your care. I pray that you will guide them, that you will protect them, and that your spirit will be with them. And Lord, I just pray that that we as a church will stand behind them and that we will remember them in our prayers and our thoughts and that we will remember to encourage our teachers because we appreciate so much what they do for our children. So Father, we just bless them in the name of Jesus. I bless each and every one of these teachers here, the school board. And Father, we just commit them to you in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you very much. Let's remember our teachers throughout the year. We entrust them with our children. They teach our children. Sometimes when the children are younger, we have experienced this, then the teacher knows better than the parents. What the teacher says, that goes. We like that. I really appreciate you teachers. I really appreciate you teaching our children. So thank you very much. Now may the grace of God and the peace of Jesus Christ be with us here this morning as we look into his word. Let's bow our head for a word of prayer. Holy God, we come before you, and God, we recognize that you are holy and we are mere human beings. And Father, I ask that your spirit will lead and guide here this morning. Father, I thank you for each one that came out this morning. I thank you that your spirit is with us here. And Father, we just praise you and we worship you. And I pray that you will guide my words, that you will help me to speak what you would want to be spoken here. So Father, I just thank you and I praise you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Once again, as I said in the German service this morning, for some reason I find this topic that I want to talk about today, I find that a bit nerve-wracking. I don't know why. The topic is letting go of control, and maybe that is why I find that very difficult. When I was working on this, I really struggled with this. How do I put this together? Am I living up to what I'm going to speak here this morning? So it really challenged me this last week as I got ready for this morning. And if we think about control, if we think about someone else controlling our lives, it angers us, right? It angers me if I feel that someone is trying to control my life. But when I feel that I'm in control of my life, that gives me much joy. I can control my life the way I want to, and I take pleasure in that. David Navarro, he has written an article he entitled it, The Five People Who Secretly Control Our Lives. In it, he says, what you may not realize is just how many people influence your lives, feeding your ideas about what is right, wrong, good, bad, and practically every other personal decision we make in our life. Some of them are bad, and some of them are good. These five names that he names here are your heroes, your enemies, your parents, your partner or spouse, and your image of who we should be. So these are the five people that we wrestle with. They influence our life. Sometimes we don't realize how much other people influence our life. And the control is something that's deeply embedded in our culture. We like to control others, and we let others control us. Now, God made me a certain way, and He gave me a gift. I believe that He gave me a gift of leadership, but with that, I easily want to take control, and when it's not mine to control. I like to, my personal nature likes to control my wife and my children. I would like to be in control of what they do, what they say, when they say certain things. That is what my human nature, I would like to control that. Now, maybe in your families it's different. Maybe it's the wife that likes to be in control. But in my life, in our family, it's been a struggle with Sarah and myself when we first got married. I wanted to be in full control, and I kept her under my thumb. And so oftentimes when we were visiting somewhere and she would start speaking, I would give her a look, and she knew that she had said enough, and she'd be quiet. And that was wrong of me. But I liked that control. And secretly, sometimes I would control that without even realizing it. And she would come to me again and again, and she would ask, why do you do that? Why don't you let me speak? But that was something that I had to learn to let go, to surrender. And some of you, some moms like to control their kids well after they're married. The kids can be in a totally different country, and they still control their kids. By influencing, by telling them how to raise their family, they control them. And they mean well, that they want what's best for their kids, but they are not realizing that they're controlling them by doing that. And there's different areas, like I could name a whole bunch of stuff. I'm sure some of you have felt this when you're in a setting, in a meeting, let's say a meeting. You're in a meeting and you start speaking, and all of a sudden you start realizing, okay, there are certain individuals, they start moving in their chairs a little bit, and you realize that they're uncomfortable with what I'm saying. So then I'll backtrack and I'll change my story so that they're comfortable with it. I let them control me. That ever happened to any of you? I think we could all identify with that, right? Now, is this a bad thing? Well, if we are wanting to control, then yes. But this morning, I want to talk about surrender, surrendering that control, surrendering fully to the Lord. If you have your Bibles with you, turn to Philippians chapter 2. We will look into Philippians chapter 2 from verse 5 through verse 8. See, when Jesus was in the desert to be tempted, I think this was maybe an area where we could say, okay, well, he was put in the desert to be tempted to see if he would be in control or if he would surrender to Christ, to God, to his heavenly Father. I mean, he was Christ, he was God, but to see if he would be in control or if he would surrender to the Father. If you have your Bibles, turn to Philippians chapter 2. I'll start reading from verse 5 here. It says, your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. When Jesus was on the cross, He may very well have been tempted to take back control, as those that were passing by would hurl insults at him. They said, "You who are going to destroy the temple and build it up in 3 days, save yourself. Come down from the cross if you are the Son of God." And the chief priests and the teachers of the law and the elders who mocked him, "He who saved others," they said, "but can't save himself. If he is the King of Israel, let him come down from the cross, and we'll believe him." Now, if we just try to imagine, here's the King of Kings on the cross, and he knows what authority he has. But we just read here that he came to obey God, his Father, fully, even unto death. But while he's hanging on the cross, and here's these men, they're hurling all these insults at him. They're saying, "Oh, if you are the King of Israel, just come down and we'll believe you. Oh, he can save others, but he can't save himself." Now, how badly you think the human inside of him, the human nature, may have wanted to take back control and come down from that cross and show the people that I can take control if I want to. But he didn't. Now, I don't know if he was even tempted to do that. We read here today that Jesus humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on the cross. So he humbled himself. He had to humble himself. He knew the power that he could have that was at his command, but he humbled himself. And Jesus went on to say, "I can do nothing on my own." And John, he talks about, "I can do nothing on my own." And he also calls those that follow him. He says, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it." So if we want to follow Christ, we need to deny ourselves and take the cross upon ourselves daily, every day. See, Jesus' answer to our control problem was surrender. Just surrender. Many of us still live under the illusion that we are in control, while nothing could be further from the truth. We think we are in control, but we are not. God is ultimately in control, as much as we like to think that we have it all under control. And it frightens us to surrender. It frightens us to just give someone else control of our lives, even if it is God. It frightens us. And maybe it is the word surrender which scares us, because this world teaches that surrender is not a good thing. If you surrender, that means you're a loser, you're losing. The world teaches that you never surrender. You never surrender to anything. You stand up for what you believe and you go with that. You do not surrender. But that's not what the Bible teaches, is it? So now the question is, will I believe what the world says, or will I believe what the Word of God says? Will I surrender or will I not? And I will talk about the different areas of our life that we need to surrender a little later. But first, by surrendering to God is a very different story than surrendering to the teachings that the world teaches us. If you fully surrender to God, it means following God's lead without knowing where he'll send you, or waiting on God's timing without knowing when it will come, expecting a miracle without knowing how God will provide, trusting God's purpose without understanding the circumstances. If we fully surrender, then these things come naturally. These things come easily. It's acknowledging him in all things and realizing that everything we have in this life comes from him, and that we can do nothing of ourselves. We think we can, but ultimately we can't. I can't take a breath without God giving me a breath. Everything that we do comes from our Heavenly Father. But so often we think that I got it all under control. It's about me. If we fully surrender, we fulfill the words that Jesus said. He says, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with them." You will be committed to prayer. You will stand up for what is right and for righteousness' sake, because you are called to do that as a child of God. Our every breath and thought will become that what Psalm 143 verse 10 says, "Teach me your will, for you are my God." That should be our every desire. God, teach me your will because you are my God. If you really think about it, there is only two choices. It's either I will be my own boss, it's a self-centered life, or it's a Christ-centered life. There is only those two choices. There is nothing in between. Sometimes we like to think that there is a lot of things between that, but in reality there isn't. Our every thought, or we should strive to talk, to think, to act, and to walk like the Word of God tells us to. Our thoughts should become the thoughts of God. You can't pursue your own agenda and God's at the same time. Matthew 6:24 says you can't serve two masters. We can either serve the one master or the other. We can't serve two of them. But so often we do. We think we do. And if we think we're serving two masters, we think that on a Sunday morning I will serve God and the rest of the week I will serve myself, then Sunday morning you're not serving God. You're still serving yourself. By surrendering to God must be a continuous thing. We don't just do that one time and think now everything is taken care of. When the devil had finished tempting Jesus in the desert there, he left him for an opportune time. He left him to tempt him when Jesus would be weak, and the same is true for us. If we think that that he will not tempt us, he will. The devil would have liked nothing more than to be able to control Jesus and Jesus' ministry here on earth. But Jesus was he surrendered to Christ, to his Father every day, like fully, completely. Now I want to draw us a little picture. I should have maybe brought out a blackboard up here so I could draw on there, but I want to draw us a little mental picture. We have all these different compartments in our life, and let's call them silos. We have these silos in our lives. We have a smaller silo here, which is our spiritual life, and then we have a little bigger silo there, which is our family life, and then a little bigger silo there yet, which is our work life, and then a bigger one yet, which is our social life, that we hang out with friends, and so it goes on, right? We have different compartments. Now, on Sunday, I am in this small silo here. I am worshiping God. I am doing everything right. But then Monday morning, or even Sunday night, I get out of this silo, and I go into the other silo here. Which is the family life here, and I try to make sure that things are being done right in here, and I try to teach my kids right from wrong. But then Monday morning, I get into the work silo here. Now I'm in here, and that doesn't suit me here. I don't want the family silo where my work one is and also my spiritual one, because here I want to be in control. I want to do things my way. I want to make the decisions what I do with my finances. I want to make the decisions how I'm being treated by other people. So this silo has nothing to do with the other one. And then there comes the one where I hang out with my friends. So that one, now it's probably Wednesday or Thursday or maybe even Saturday. And now here I'm with my friends. Now I've forgotten about the spiritual silo. Here I'm going to be in control too. And I remember so clear when I was a teenager, when I hung out with my friends, I wanted to be the one that was the most popular guy. It was all about me. I could say the best jokes. I could tell the best jokes. I could make my friends laugh. It was about me. There was nothing spiritual about that. Now how often do we do that? Sometimes even right from church, we will go to wherever. We will hang out with our friends, and our language becomes filthy. Our thoughts become filthy. Our actions don't show what they should be showing. We're in a totally different silo. And the Bible says surrender in every area, everything. Like everything that we do, we need to surrender. Romans chapter 12, verse 1 says, "So, brothers and sisters, I beg you to offer your lives as a living sacrifice to Him." We are supposed to offer our lives as a living sacrifice to Christ, and that doesn't just mean on a Sunday. That means every day of the week. Everything that we do, everything that that we have, we need to surrender to Christ. Back in our earlier Christian years, my wife and myself, I sometimes admired my wife, how she could so easily pray to God. I sometimes said if she wants to walk across the street, she won't cross the street until she's prayed about that. She would pray about everything. And I admired that in her, and I learned from her in that. And during that time, so often when I went to work, I said, God, teach me your ways. And I said, God, you have two hands, you have two feet, you have two eyes, two ears, and you have a mouth. Use it. Use me. But then comes a time where I forget about that. I forget about that, and I want to be in control again. And then I try to do God's work rather than allowing God to work through me. As Christians, our lives should line up with the life of Jesus. He was obedient unto death. He didn't even consider his own life worthy of saving. He knew the Father's will, so he was obedient unto death. And we may very often say, well, yeah, he was fully God, so of course he knew the will of God. So I don't know the will of God, that's why I try to do things my way. But we can know the will of God if we are at his presence, if we sit at his feet and we ask him, God, what is your will in my life? We can know the will of God. He gave us a whole book. He says, study this book. You have a whole book. Study this book. We know the word, his will. It's all in there. And then on top of that, he says, I will send you the Spirit. I will send you the Holy Spirit. He will remind you of things. He will teach you all things. So we can know the will of God. We can, and then out of that we pray and ask God, do so or so for me, bless so or so, because we know that that is his will. And then instead of trying harder, we trust more. And when different circumstances or tough circumstances come about, we don't say, God, what am I going to do now? We say, Lord, what will you do? Maybe there's someone here today that is at the end of his or her rope, and you're just like, okay, I don't know what to do anymore. I've tried to control my life for so long, and I'm at the end of myself. I'm a mess. I don't know where to go from here. And if you look over your life, you can so clearly see how you made choices all along, and you never allowed God to make choices in your life. And now you're at the end of yourself, and you say, God, there's nothing left but surrender. Because within me there's no way out. I can't do this. See, Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. He says, just come to me. And there is a way. There is hope. With God, nothing is impossible. With us, so many things seem impossible. But with God, nothing is impossible. So my challenge to you this week is surrender. Surrender your life in every area. Your work. Now, we all have agendas. We all have things that we want in our life. We want good friends. We want a comfortable life. We want a secure life. We want all these things. But then it's all still about me. Me, me, me. Now, a lot of these things God wants to give us, but they are a byproduct of following him. When we surrender to him and we are obedient to him, he wants to bless his children. He desires for his children to have a good life, to have a secure life, but it needs to be about him, not about me. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. John 14, verse 6, and then 12 to 15 says, very truly I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works that I have done, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father, and I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. If you love me, keep my command. We like the first part there. He will do anything for us. But the last part, if you love me, keep my command. Very often we sit there and we say, I'm waiting on God. The reality is he's waiting on us. Let's bow our head for a word of prayer. Father God, I thank you so much. I thank you that your Spirit is with us and your Word is with us. And it's alive and sharp and it's active. Father, I pray that everyone here would surrender their life fully to you, Lord. Because we know that you are the ultimate God. You are our Father and you know what is best for us. So Father, I pray that your blessing will be on each and every one here this morning. I pray that you will continue to do a work in their lives. Lord, if there is any unrighteousness in anyone here, Lord, I pray that you will continue to convict them, that they will come to a place of repentance. And Father, I pray that they will surrender their lives fully to you, Lord. So Father, I pray that you will bless them, keep them as we go from here. Lord, I just commit them to you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you very much for coming out. May the love of our Father be with you. Go in peace.